age of wearable technology.
Amazing things happen when we merge technology with our body.
In our pursuit of progress, if we undermine the morals that define us, what good is our beloved progress then?
Neural control. This is happening. The only question that remains is how far will we allow it to go?
In one of their collisions, when they collided these particles together, they saw things. They were apparitions they didn't expect to see. There's going to come an Armageddon. There's coming an apocalypse. I hope you're ready. I hope you're ready. I hope you are. Hope you're ready to meet the Lord. Here's what I worry about coming out of that place, is all this spirit deception, using it to deceive people. They connect spirituality and science together. They've got what they want when that happens. Father, in Jesus' name, there may be somebody sitting in this house this morning that's awake now. They've wakened up. They're alarmed and they're worried. We'll do something about it in Jesus' name and for Jesus' sake. Amen.
Days begin with light. Light, you see, is everywhere. Light is life. Light connects us with others, near and far. It entertains and inspires both young and old. Light enables us to see things never imagined. It will drive economies of the future. With light, we can diagnose and treat disease. It helps protect and secure our communities. Light will be key in discovering solutions to society's most pressing problems. And as the lights go down around the world and our days end.
And as the lights go down around the world and our days end. And as the lights go down around the world. And our days end.
Our future will continue to be enabled by light.
I saw a star fallen from heaven to earth, and he was given the key to the shaft of the bottomless pit. He opened the shaft of the bottomless pit, and from the shaft rose smoke, like the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened with the smoke from the shaft. Then from the smoke came locusts on the earth, and they were given power like the power of scorpions of the earth. They were told not to harm the grass of the earth or any green plant or any tree, but only those people who do not have the seal of God on their foreheads. They were allowed to torment them for 5 months, but not to kill them. And their torment was like the torment of a scorpion when it stings someone. And in those days people will seek death and will not find it. they will long to die, but death will flee from them. They have as king over them the angel of the bottomless pit. His name in Hebrew is Abaddon, and in Greek he is called Apollyon. The first woe has passed. Behold, two woes are still to come.
And it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days will I pour out my spirit.
I was in prayer during the night, and I got the vision of this Abaddon, and it was horrific. Then in the morning, that morning, I got the actual prophecy. I was hearing it, parts of it, for a few days. Prepare for the day of Abaddon. He shall rise from beneath the earth, smoke shall ascend to the heavens. He shall be accompanied by his army of demons. He will have power to cause much pain and suffering, but not the power of death. He shall make men flee in horror, and they will not escape this torment and pain. The army and its king of the locusts shall remain among the unrepentant for 5 months. Turn from your evil ways, you men of the earth. I am a just God and a forgiving God. Return to me and escape the wrath to come. All those that seek me with a repentant heart will enter in. Come as time moves quickly and the days grow short.
About something, it's a really good topic you had today concerning this, the urgency that we're in, and concerning CERN, not so much for the machinery, but the intent. And this probably won't be long enough to say it, but there's a film called Symmetry. To give you an idea of this film, it was made specifically for CERN. It's also a message. Here's one of the captions in the film that people will find in the film as it's released. It will ultimately ask if one loves the particle more than himself. And then they ask, would you become one with the particle?
Really?
Yeah. And so I of course it would take a little more time to that's one of the captions in the film. Go ahead.
But the name of the film you say is Symmetry. Is that with a C?
Symmetry. S-Y-M-M-E-T-R-Y. They allowed this to be filmed inside of CERN. So it's not, it's not just an ordinary film. It's more of an intention. The scientists were very collaborative in this film. They did work and help produce this film, and it has an intent. It has an announcement. If a person, and it's not conspiracy theory, this is how science seems to edify itself. But they have an intent here, something very real, something. Yes.
And now they're releasing that the same time the CERN is being fired up.
Yeah, it's in that neighborhood. CERN itself, everybody knows about CERN. It's a particle accelerator. And they've already found the Higgs boson particle, which is accompanied, which in, within that field, which is a field that is the other realm we can't see. That's, in fact, evidence that that realm exists. What they're looking for now is what powers all the fields, which is dark matter. It is they call it the God particle. Now, Pastor, it is my opinion, my professional opinion, that they are going to discover this particle. And there's nothing that will prohibit them from doing so. CERN is actually in its startup phases at the moment, because they'll be doing checks and rechecks. There are some byproducts of CERN, of course, that people will likely experience. That's not conspiracy again. That's a fact. And
what do you mean by byproduct? Well, are you talking about demons and demonic entities, and
Pastor,
or are you talking about pressure on the brain? changes.
If it were just demons, right? Because we've been given power over them, that would be one thing. But one of the problems with CERN is that it directly affects the psyche of everybody. You were talking about ISIS and the holes in the Arctic. When CERN started up, when they did one of the experiments in 2012, that's also the time that al-Baghdadi moved and shifted from being one entity to another in Syria. Beheadings were taking place, massive beheadings that they didn't tell the public, began spontaneously at that same date. And then when the holes were discovered in 2013 and 14, well, that's when ISIS, as soon as they broke open, ISIS really went full throttle. It did, in fact, unleash something in the world. The effects that CERN has on the brain are measurable. They're measurable effects. That's why it's underground so far.
Are you aware that you have awakened a lot of people to the dangers of the CERN LHC, and how does this feel?
It's nothing to feel comfortable about. Dangers are never something that you feel good when you dissipate them.
Now here's one of the things about this. This antimatter is also called dark matter. And dark matter has energy attached to it. And the energy affects people. It affects them. And remember, when you produce antimatter, you got to contain it. Because if you don't contain it, you got to contain it. That's the biggest problem, containing it. Because if you don't contain it, it just goes wild. But they do know this. From what they've experienced so far, it has an effect on people. Dark matter has an effect on people. It causes some people to go screaming mad. It controls people. It is an enormously powerful thing. It's pulling something out of hell that you don't want any part to do with and turning it loose.
You have to remember our world is made up of matter. The antimatter is what we can't see, what we can't touch, what we can't feel, though we interact with it every day. A lot of people like to think of antimatter as the other dimension, which is the opposite of this dimension. It's an inconceivable place that is hostile inherently. It's not under control, it's very hostile. So there's a physical effect to the spiritual world in antimatter. And often, demonic entities and all these other paranormal things are attracted to antimatter. For every gram of antimatter that's produced, and then it's bought into this world, when they produce it, it attracts things from another dimension coming here. What is CERN going to do? It will allow humanity to produce pounds of antimatter. What's happening, that is the unseen portion of dark matter. And of course you have the angels which govern what that realm can and cannot do, because everything is balanced, the subject of Lucifer in the spiritual sense, because God gives everything balance. Everything has balance. There is dark, there is light, there is good, there is bad. Everything has balance. CERN has yielded so many results and gave a true definition of paranormal activity. It's beyond me that a lot of people cannot get this through the truth of the word. They can't. Antimatter is being pulled out of nowhere, out of this other dimension, which is nowhere but everywhere. In consequence to that, they found out antimatter has a specific type of energy signature that they can, in fact, detect. This is how they, it's part of the process of pulling it out. Well, as it comes to find out, some of the not so good consequences of this process have to do with the human psyche. With all the experiments they found, they have found out why paranormal activity exists. With CERN, as they begin to collide these protons, dark matter is going to be produced in great numbers, in greater and greater numbers. Not only the matter, but the energy signature is going to also be released. into this realm. You know what that's going to cause? It's going to cause the dark energy signature within people to begin to activate more and more. You see, it's going to become difficult for people to stay contained or controlled. In essence, they're going to become violent. They're going to have vivid dreams. The darkness within a person is absolutely going to begin to surface. And this is not theoretical. This is not some theory somebody thought of. This is absolutely 100% quantifiable, and it's happened before. It's going to happen in greater numbers this time. It will take effect.
But I did it. I actually did it, Doctor. See, viewing was only the beginning, but like a rudimentary computer, it only took time and development before a new model was born. You harness a wormhole, speed up one end, and slow down the other end.
Go on.
I can't.
Mr. Darnell, you realize...
Please, I can't. Let's leave it at this.
How does it work?
You have to understand, if I answer that question, you could rip a hole through everything as we know it.
But that's why you're here, isn't it? To change the past, so you're gonna have to give me something.
Dr. Bryant, I was under the impression it was never a good idea to force a patient to divulge anything they weren't comfortable with.
I can't keep doing this.
All right. I know this must be frustrating. I can't give you everything. It just wouldn't be safe.
I'm listening.
You say you like science?
I do.
To go back and read the concepts presented by Hawking, Einstein, Lewis, light speed, black holes, wormholes. They were so close. There was just one small piece missing. I'm sure you're aware or somewhat familiar with the concept of wormholes.
Sure, yeah, they're fascinating to wonder about.
If you don't mind, could you tell me what you know?
They're a consequence of Einstein's theory of general relativity. A wormhole, in theory, would act as a shortcut or a passageway through space and time.
The physics are even simpler than your definition. A wormhole creates a tunnel, effectively cutting through two locations in space-time.
Yeah, therefore eliminating the need for three-dimensional travel through space. No more rocket ships. I like Stargate, too.
Oh, wow, Stargate. It's been a long time since I've seen that movie. Who is that guy? He's really good in that old Western.
Kurt Russell,
he was good, wasn't he?
Listen, nothing you're telling me is new information, right? The theories about wormholes have existed for a long time, but nobody knows if they actually exist or how to find them.
But I do. They're everywhere. Just a matter of seeing them or harnessing them.
But you haven't explained either. How do you see them? How do you harness them? A machine, some sort of gateway?
Of course you need a machine to sustain a wormhole. But this is where I stop. I have given you the gun. Let me keep the bullets.
Please continue.
I found a way to go back. I was alone, but I found it. My old partner was the only one that knew, but for now, it'll stay that way. The only question is, can the ripples I create be enough to change the future? Or create an alternate one?
Ripples?
Think of the water in that glass as time. Time moves forward constantly, untouched, as still as the water. Go back and try to change something, and it creates a ripple effect. Change has to catch up with time. And everything around it either changes or suffers.
If you've ever been exposed to soap operas, the music in the soundtrack should evoke memories of a long-running show.
Like sands through the hourglass, so are the days of our lives.
Like sands through the hourglass, so are the days of our lives. That's the kind of subtlety being leveraged by the filmmaker. Darnell, the time traveler and inventor of time travel who destroyed the future, says, "Think of the water in that glass as time. Time moves forward constantly. Untouched, it's as still as the water. Go back and try to change something, bang, and it creates a ripple effect. Read between the lines. The particle collision pictured creates a ripple effect in time, a time impact event. Who is trying to go back or forward to try to change an outcome? Darnell is. That's why he's there meeting with Dr. Pyatt and speaking so persuasively. Darnell himself is playing the role of the destroyer of worlds, the dancing Lord Shiva. Under the lamp, we see an idol of Shiva doing the cosmic dance of destruction, a miniature of the one featured at the CERN facility. There's a horned mask on the wall that represents the horned god Cernunnos, the god of the abyss, who is continually being invoked in ceremonies where magic circles are cast with salt, just like in the Symmetry film. Yes, Cernunnos, C-E-R-N-U-N-N-O-S. Also, Nodens, Abaddon, Apollyon the Destroyer. It's a clever set. The table lamp paints light on the wall in the shape of an hourglass, hinting of a measure of the sands of time. Under the lamp, you'll find a pitcher of water, a reservoir as drawn from the river of time. Mr. Darnell's pocket watch rests on the coffee table with his time water glass, with the hinged case being a model of folded time-space. The box of tissues on the table is a cube. Think of the cube in the Marvel comic universe, which has to do with a multi-dimensional binding and the control of vast time-space energies. Again, what kind of machine are they talking about in the clip? Did you see the picture on the wall that artfully illustrates the particle collisions? Darnell mentioned small pieces, like subatomic particles. He mentioned a gun and bullets, and the collider fires protons like bullets from a machine gun. Did you notice the picture of the full moon next to the one of the particle collisions? That's a celestial timekeeper, the one that rules the night according to the foundational cosmological text of Genesis chapter 1. It's appointed for signs and for seasons and for days and years, and to give light on the earth, which is a matter of the revelation of supernatural insight and the Hebrew Moedim, the prophetic schedule of holy days. The moon silently affects the tides of the seas on earth in endless cycles. With that influence due to the interaction of gravity relative to mass, and with the water and the sea as a metaphor for time, that's a potent symbol in the context of the particle collider, with its vast array of enormously powerful ring magnets arrayed in a giant ring. Sonic energy is also used to accelerate the particles, so the LHC literally sings as the particles dance. Symmetry's opera and dance. When Darnell bangs the coffee table and we see the imagery of the particle beam collision so clearly illustrated, is there any doubt about what time machine they're talking about? With all the clues, do they really need to say it? Need more evidence? Darnell doesn't actually hit the coffee table with his fist, not directly. He hits a book that sits on the table, which is wrapped around with two rubber bands, one red and one green. The red band represents a stream of particles traveling around the LHC, and the green band is the opposing stream. The crossing of the bands represents the crossing of the streams where the collisions occur. He strikes the rubber bands at their crossing. Bang! What's in Darnell's little black book? Notes on particle physics, time-space manipulation, and time travel? Are the bands made of rubber because time is flexible and in flux, able to contract and expand? Is there a redshift of the beams relative to one another, where he's slowing down one and speeding up the other, which Darnell had already claimed was a general principle involved with harnessing a wormhole? There's another aspect of the rubber band bound book that should be mentioned. The two men are actually the same man who traveled back in time on a mission to convince himself not to make the mistake of building the device that would destroy the world in 50 years' time. The rubber bands represent the life of the man. Were there two at once, at the crossing of the future with the past in the present?
Stephen Hawking, he called the God particle could destroy the universe. He keeps warning.
You see, it's going to become difficult for people to stay contained or controlled.
In the book of the Revelation of John, it does speak about a messenger from the upper levels coming down to earth and opening up a doorway to the bottomless pit down inside the earth to let things out. So maybe this is research being done to develop the technology we need here to do such a thing. I don't know. I mean, it's just a wild guess.
Right. And it's interesting, I think, that, you know, it seemed like even in the Old Testament, whenever there are mentions of high places and things like that, it required, at least for the fallen entities, required some sort of sacrifice or some sort of ritual for these fallen entities to come through. It seems like God's angels are freely able to traverse as they will, but the fallen entities require some sort of key, if you will, for us to allow them in, so to speak. So perhaps this is just a large human project to create the biggest doorways to the fallen entities to come through. I mean, what are your thoughts on that?
Yeah. I mean, I think we're going to see some rather astounding events in the next 12 to 24 months because other factors in biblical prophecy seem to be coming to play later this year. And that would then require the presence of this fake alien landing invasion or whatever. But to do that, they're going to have to be a lot of them appear. And I'm wondering if God himself isn't going to open up one of these portals to cast Satan and his minions out of his universe down into ours for the final battle. At that time, of course, these beings will appear all over the place, and I think technology for them to fly around, saucers and that kind of stuff, have been developed already since 1952 or so, when we started sharing bases, underground bases, with these fallen ones, quote-unquote grays and aliens. But I think this has been prepared for the time when the gateway opens and these beings are pushed out of their level to ours.
How could that play out? I mean, it seems to me that the Obama or whoever, Hillary or whoever this president's going to be announcing alien presence is not going to be enough to really convince the whole world. It seems like there has to be more of a manifestation, in my opinion. But what are your thoughts on how that might look?
Yeah, I'm sure that this will happen. I think the release of their presence will be such that the people of the earth will say, they're here and the governments were lying. In essence, it won't be trusting a government release of the thing. It will be so obvious. They'll be in the skies, like in the movie V or in 4th of July, the beings and their craft, big ones, will be over major cities or locations that will be on TV worldwide, and people will go, they're here, are they friendly? Now, I think that this will have to come at the height of a global threat so real that people will say to anyone, help us avoid this or we're going to be extinct, the human race.
Listen, it's not just one experiment they're about to perform. This thing is going to run 6 months continuously, colliding protons near the speed of light to analyze particles, exotic particles that are made at the beginning of the Big Bang. That's why they call it the Big Bang machine. It's the only way to observe these particles, which wink in and out of existence in a fraction of time. They found the force that holds the dark energy or the dark matter away from this realm. They call it the wall. There's another name for that. A name of which that those particles they're going to find, they found part of it. They're going to find the other pieces that are in that wall. And when they find the other pieces to this wall, they will then be able to undo that wall. There's another name for that wall, the veil. Call it the veil. It holds back that realm. They found out what's holding back the dark energy from, because it would be absolutely destructive if the two met. But they found out. Now with this as a weapon, there is no counter weapon to this.
We need some outside universal threat. I occasionally think how quickly our differences worldwide would vanish if we were facing an alien threat.
So of course this all has to do with CERN, and even on CERN's logo, as many have exposed as well, you've got the 666 spinning. We see CERN being used by even heavy metal bands like Megadeth. You've got Super Collider there, and this is CERN being shown on the album cover. And as I said, it's to do with the transfiguration of the planet. It's the false Jesus Sananda coming off the leeching off the back of Christ, because you know, as you know, some of you may know, Christ, the transfiguration was to do with Christ, and he formed a bridge to the Father in the Bible. And this is obviously the inversion of that. It's the transfiguration of their kingdom. It's the birthing of hell on earth. It's the bridge from hell to earth, from the abyss to earth, to break loose the ones that are imprisoned, the spirits, the fallen, as the Bible all describes.
There's another name for that wall, the veil.
They know that they could be opening or parting the veil.
It was on the Day of Atonement that Moses came down from Mount Sinai for the second time, and he put a veil over his face.
Moses was there with the Lord 40 days and 40 nights without eating bread or drinking water, and he wrote on the tablets the words of the covenant, the Ten Commandments. When Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of the covenant law in his hands, he was not aware that his face was radiant because he had spoken with the Lord. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, his face was radiant, and they were afraid to come near him. But Moses called to them. So Aaron and all the leaders of the community came back to him, and he spoke to them. Afterward, all the Israelites came near him, and he gave them all the commands the Lord had given him on Mount Sinai. When Moses finished speaking to them, he put a veil over his face. But whenever he entered the Lord's presence to speak with him, he removed the veil until he came out. And when he came out and told the Israelites what he had been commanded, they saw that his face was radiant. Then Moses would put the veil back over his face until he went in to speak with the Lord.
And are not like Moses, who used to put a veil over his face so that the sons of Israel would not look intently at the end of what was fading away. But their minds were hardened, for until this very day at the reading of the Old Covenant, the same veil remains unlifted, because it is removed in Christ. But to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their heart. But whenever a person turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty.
The veil was first put on right on the Day of Atonement. I believe this will also be the day that the veil is removed. The word veil means to cover or conceal. The word unveil means to reveal. In a wedding, the veil of the bride is removed. We are the bride of Christ, and our veil will be completely removed on the day when we see him face to face. 1 Corinthians 13:12 says,
"For now we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part. Then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known."
The Day of Atonement is known as the face-to-face day because only on this day was the high priest allowed to go into the Holy Holies and live to tell about it. On no other day of the year was anyone allowed to ever enter the Holy of Holies. The high priest would remove the veil and enter into the Holy of Holies. When Christ died as our atonement, the veil was ripped in two, and we can now boldly enter the throne of grace to find mercy in our time of need. The Day of Atonement is the day of the unveiling, or the day of revealing. Colossians 3:4 says,
"When Christ, who is our life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory."
Isaiah 26:21 says,
"And the earth will give birth to the departed spirits. Come, my people, Enter into your rooms and close your doors behind you. Hide for a little while until indignation runs its course. For behold, the Lord is about to come out from his place to punish the inhabitants of the earth for their iniquity. And the earth will reveal her bloodshed and will no longer cover her slain.
So this Large Hadron Collider was started up. You say, what in the world does something like that have to do with me and the Bible? It has a lot to do with you and the Bible. I cannot and will not attempt to speak as a physicist. It would make me look like a fool. My purpose is to try to be a liaison between them and you. Is to try to take what's going on in that collider and break it down to where I can understand it and I can give it out so you can understand it to where it makes an application to your life and to this world as we know it today. For what is happening in that collider is an astounding thing. So I want to read something to you this morning from what's called a theoretical physicist. This man, his name is Stephen Hawking. He's well known throughout the world. Anyone that has anything to do with nuclear energy or has anything to do with physics knows this man. And he is one that some rate even on the level of Einstein and of that level. And so I'm going to read to you what this man has to say about what's happening right now in CERN, Switzerland. Listen carefully. These are the words of Stephen Hawking. He recently warned the reactivation in March of CERN's Large Hadron Collider could pose grave dangers to our planet. The ultimate reality, check, we are warned. Hawking has come straight out and said the God particle, and this is what you've heard referred to time and again as the Higgs boson particle, the God particle found by CERN could destroy the universe. Now let that settle in. This man is an atheist, and he says there is no God. Yet he says that what's happening right now in CERN, Switzerland, has the potential to destroy the universe.
Lucifer lives in the antimatter. He lives in a different frequency or a different dimension, a spiritual world, a spiritual realm. But he comes in to contact us. He will try to manipulate you. He will try to tempt you by manipulating your brain. This is why the Bible tells us to put on the whole armor of God. And Apostle Paul says, the helmet of salvation. Another scripture, he says, put on the mind of Christ. Another scripture says, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Dr. Lester Sumner used to teach us all the time that the mind is the battleground for the soul. So it's the manipulation. And so what they're doing at CERN is the manipulating the darkness, the dark matter. And they're doing it by the collisions of protons. It's more than just a potential massive earth-changing, universe-changing explosion. But it's a manipulation of the frequencies on which humans on Earth are living. Imagine if you could take everybody under and manipulate the frequencies that we all are operating in into a different dimension or frequency. Imagine if the whole world could be dropped into this hole, into this change of reality, if you will, or dimensions. And that's what they're trying to do with the RFID microchip, folks. And now, I'm not a scientist, but the radio frequency identification device is to not just, it's not just to link you to a computer, it's to manipulate your DNA or your mind to bring you a couple frequencies down to where you can be manipulated. The only thing that it won't manipulate, get this, folks, this is great, is it can't go through the blood of Jesus. I'm not joking you. I mean, there's prophecy teams that work for the federal government, and they know this. that they can't manipulate the mind of Christians because they can't get through the blood of Jesus. Folks, give your life to Jesus Christ. We're running out of time. We're in the last days. The spirit of the Antichrist. Why do you think these little towers are everywhere? Radio frequency towers. They're not even being used for anything right now. But they're putting them everywhere. They're not cell phone towers. They're the towers that will be used to help change the frequencies, to try to control the masses. But they can't control us that are saved.
Looking for how God holds everything together. That's why they call it the God particle. They're trying to find Jesus, but they don't want to find Jesus. So they're trying to find what is it that holds all matter together. However, they also believe that there are parallel realities around us, other dimensions, and there could be other intelligence there. Another thing we Christians already know, right? Why not just come and ask us? You don't need to build a collider. However, there's a reason God put them on the other side of that veil, and you might not want to open the door. And here's the thing, their own director of CERN has gave interviews to the British press in which he admits that's what they're trying to do. They want to open a door to another dimension. And he said, when we open this door, he said, something might come through it. Actually, they built, the Hindu god of destruction that destroys at the molecular level is right out in front of the offices of CERN, and it's dedicated to Shiva.
I'm going to put it on the screen. You'll show it. Because I've seen it, and I said, this is a false god. What in the... I couldn't find anything about it because I need to get some books and read a little bit more.
It's named after Apollyon, the gateway to the god Apollo. But what does the book of Revelation say? That an angel comes down with a key to the bottomless pit and opens that gateway. And guess who is the god down in there? The king over the bottomless pit, Apollyon, Abaddon, the king of the bottomless pit. And we're trying right there to open a gateway.
Smart, when we was talking back there, I said, you know, it sounds to me like you're describing they're trying to open the door, the gate to hell.
Right.
Okay. Well, here's the thought. God literally sealed and locked demons into the earth that would not be released until the last days. Mm-hmm. And now we have evidence that man is the one that's trying to open the door and release them.
We have the power to overcome our own flesh because the darkness in this world is about to be pulled out of everything. Everything with darkness in it. That darkness is about to surface in a way that no one ever forecasted or thought possible, but it's absolutely going to take place. And the only way a person can overcome this is through the true power of the Holy Spirit. And to stay within the blood of the Lamb, there is no hypocrisy in purity. There is no hatred in purity. There is no accusation in purity, and people need to be in that purity and truth, not acting like they're in the purity. They have to be there. It has to be in their hearts. They have to do everything they can do right now so they can be strong enough to endure. None of us knows when we're absolutely going, but I for one, intend to finish this race, and I'm trying to sound an alarm that something very different is going to be all too evident to everybody who believes in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And without Him in truth, they're not going to make it. They will not make it.
And it shall come to pass in that day, saith the Lord, that I will cut off thy horses out of the midst of thee, and I will destroy thy chariots, and I will cut off the cities of thy land, and throw down all thy strongholds, and I will cut off witchcrafts out of thine hand, and thou shalt have no more soothsayers. Thy graven images also will I cut off, and thy standing images out of the midst of thee, and thou shalt no more worship the work of thine hands.
One of the tragedies of Nepal's earthquake is that many of the country's most treasured cultural monuments were destroyed in the blink of an eye. I'm standing in what was the Fashi Dega Temple. It was dedicated to Shiva, the Hindu god of destruction, and now there's very little of it left.
Prepare for the day of Abaddon. He shall rise from beneath the earth, smoke shall ascend to the heavens. He shall be accompanied by his army of demons. He will have power to cause much pain and suffering, but not the power of death. He shall make men flee in horror, and they will not escape this torment and pain. The army and its king of the locusts shall remain among the unrepentant for 5 months. Turn from your evil ways, you men of the earth. I am a just God and a forgiving God. Return to me and escape the wrath to come. All those that seek me with a repentant heart will enter in. Come as time moves quickly and the days grow short.
There's going to come an Armageddon. There's coming an apocalypse. I hope you're ready. I hope you are. I hope you're ready to meet the Lord.